Okay, so we're going to make a start. So it's a huge pleasure for me to welcome Patricia Fara to the Department of Science and Technology Studies for this evening's seminar. For those of you who are PGTAs, you may be interested to know that I was once a PGTA, and I was a PGTA on Patricia's course. So
that's why all my students did so well.
And I was reflecting. So some of you may know that I've been doing a project on Joseph Banks, and actually the first time I heard about Joseph Banks was in your class on Joseph Banks. So thank you very much. Patricia comes here from Clare College and the Department of History and Philosophy of Science at Cambridge. Patricia has produced many truly important books in the history of science, among other things. And I will draw your attention to a few of them, because if you haven't read them, you should immediately go and get them and read them. So, Sympathetic Attractions, monograph on the history of magnetism in the 18th century, which came out in 1996. An Entertainment for Angels, which looked at the place of electricity in public culture in the 18th century, which was published with Icon in 2002. Newton, The Making of Genius, which came out in 2002, and is a fabulous work, and I think essential reading in our discipline for an incredibly original and interesting take on Mr. Newton. And then Sex, Botany and Empire, which came out in 2003 on Linnaeus and Banks, the best title for a book in the history of science, I think, for a very long time, and about Joseph Banks, so what more can you ask for? Some very important works on women in science, Pandora's Breaches in 2004 and Scientists Anonymous in 2005. And then more recently, Science, a 4,000-year history, a very ambitious, again, essential reading, go out and get your copy now. And then more recently, in 2012, a book on Erasmus Darwin, which I admit I haven't got to yet. That's when I got back here and then I had other things to do, but it's on my list and I'm sure it will be as good as all the other ones. So the paper that Patricia is going to present to us today is called Voting for Science, Women at Work in World War I. This is also going to be a book. So you all have lists of Christmas and birthday presents coming up. So now you know what to put on it. Early 2018, this is the one to read. Thank you very much. And please welcome Patricia to the department.
Well, Simon, thank you for that. Far too flattering introduction. Thank you very much. And thank you everybody for coming. So today I'm going to be talking about a very small group of extraordinary women who were scientists and doctors in the First World War. And as you've gathered from what Simon says, I'm normally an 18th century historian. But I got into this project because the archivist at Newnham College showed me this book. It's about that big. And it's completely handmade. The cover is hand embroidered and hand woven. And when you open it up, it's in beautiful black and red lettering, and it lists all the women from Newnham who contributed towards the war effort in 1914 to 18, and it's also sorted them out by categories as to what they did. So the first few pages are all about women who were scientists, who were doctors, who got all sorts of national awards both here and overseas, and then it goes through women who worked in the civil service and the war office, and then it goes on right down to the women who made the sandwiches for the Red Cross. So I became more and more intrigued by this group of women. Though I realised after a while that they'd been doubly neglected in the historical literature, because most feminist historians have focused on the far larger numbers of women who were working in munitions factories, who were working in transport, in chemical laboratories. So there's masses has been written about them. And on the other hand, all the books that have been written about science during the war inevitably focus mainly on men because there was such a small group of women. So I've tried to retrieve information about this group, although it is quite hard. One of the women who contributed enormously to leaving information about women in the war is this woman, Agnes Conway, and she became an archaeologist after the war. But at the time, she was hadn't much to do. She just graduated. She was the daughter of the director of the Imperial War Museum. And she decided to make her project collecting information about what women were doing during the war. And this is an exhibition that she set up in 1918, where thousands of people came, which had displays all over it about everything that women had been doing. And after the war, in 1919, she sent out a questionnaire to a lot of scientific laboratories, to industries, to officers, asking them to report on what women had been doing during the war. And there's a huge archive of that correspondence in the Imperial War Museum. Another source of history, a small source of information, is oral history. This is a field hospital in Cambridge. For those of you who know Cambridge, you might not recognise the University Library, but this is the University Library site during the First World War. And you can see there's all these open-sided wards because they really believed in the virtues of fresh air. And any of you who've been to Cambridge in the middle of February will know that that is not a very sensible thing to do. So they walled them in after a while. And there's recordings, in particular, a young woman called Ruth Dingley, who was a second year undergraduate at Newnham. And she went along to help. A lot of students went along to help at the hospital. And she observed the operating theatre for 2 weeks. And at the end of that period, she was put in charge of anaesthetics. And she did that right through the war. And then she became a doctor afterwards. There's also some material evidence of these women. So before the war, a lot of them were going on processions. And these are just two of the very large embroidered silk banners that have been preserved. So on the left, you can see this female graduate, and she's locked in a cage behind a fence with, it says, the convicts and the lunatics, because women weren't allowed to vote until, no women were allowed to vote until 1918. And when women went on these in these processions, they were always very popular. They always wore their full academic dress, and they all got masses of applause from the spectators lining the side of the route. And they were also, the suffrage movement aligned itself with modernity and with science and with progress. So this banner of Marie Curie and radium is just an example of how they showed their support for science and obviously also for exemplary women. So the suffrage movement achieved two great things during the war. First of all, they achieved the vote. In 1918, the vote was given to all men and all women over 30. 10 years later, all women got the vote. And they also received a lot of credit for all the work that they'd done during the war. And the quotation on the right is from the Minister of Munitions, it was Lord George, in 1916. "Our armies have been saved, victory assured, by the women in the munition factories, where they helped to produce aeroplanes, howitzer bombs, shrapnel bullets, shells, machine tools, mines, and have taken part in shipbuilding." So by the end of the war, it was absolutely impossible to deny that women were capable of carrying out all these jobs that were usually done by men. So unsurprisingly, this double triumph of the vote and being recognised for their ability to work led to a great feeling of triumphalism amongst a lot of women. So Millicent Fawcett, who was one of the leading suffragists, she was incredibly optimistic. She said, "The war revolutionised the industrial position of women. It found them serfs and left them free." And that's the view that has been perpetuated by some historians. It's a view of the Great War as the great watershed. Of course, there's a lot of women who think that, historians and women at the time, who think that that was an unrealistic expectation. For one thing, at the time, a lot of women were far more interested in achieving economic parity for doing the same work than they were in the vote. So Virginia Woolf, for example, she was privileged enough, she had an aunt who fell off a horse in Bombay, so she inherited some money. "So the news of my legacy reached me one night about the same time that the act was passed that gave votes to women. Of the two, the vote and the money I owned seemed infinitely the more important." And women who worked for their money instead of relying on their family inheritance often voiced the same sentiments, in particular, a particular relevance for me, scientists and doctors who were women who complained that they were doing the same work as the men, but they were still getting far less money. So after the war, a lot of people, a lot of women, felt that all the old stereotypes had returned, that the war hadn't achieved anything, that they'd gone back to where they were before. And Cicely Hamilton was a very active suffrage campaigner. She was a journalist. And after the war, she said, "The battle we thought won is going badly against us. We're retreating where we once advanced. In the eyes of modern statesmen, women are not personalities. They are reproductive faculty personified, which means that they are back at secondary existence, counting only as normal, as wives and mothers of sons." And a lot of historians have perpetuated that view, the complete opposite of Millicent Fawcett's. Instead of the war changing everything and improving it forever, nothing happened and we all went back to where we were before the war. But I think there's an emerging view amongst historians that there is a picture of continuity. The suffrage movement had been going since the middle of the 19th century. There were already quite a few women at university studying science at the end of the 19th and the early 20th centuries. So as I see it, the war was indeed an exceptional interlude, and in some ways everything did revert to the status quo. But on the other hand, everybody, including women, knew that they were capable of carrying out this industrial and scientific work. So I think it was impossible for the people to go back to exactly the same position as they were in before. And I think just as the people in the women and the men in the First World War, there was continuity with the previous period going back to the mid-19th century, I think we also have continuity with that period, even though it's 100 years ago. And so one of my interests in doing this is to use these sort of historical studies to think about the position of women in science and industry and medicine today. So I'm going to divide the talk into four parts, and because I'm sort of rather constrained, I've found lots and lots and lots of women, but I haven't found much information about each particular one. So I'm going to be slightly constrained by that. So I'm going to talk about a few particular women. So the first three parts, I've divided them into just groups: scientific outsiders, doctors, and scientists as leaders. And then in the fourth part is a bit different. I'm going to talk about what happened during the interwar period. So the first section I called scientific outsiders, and that was just a signal that even when women were doing science or medicine, they were not treated in the same way as the men. And this is Mary Stopes, who's obviously most famous for all the birth control clinics that she set up. But she was also a paleobotanist, and she was the first female lecturer to be employed at Manchester University. And as she said it in 1914, "Women high up in scientific positions, women with international reputations, are shut out from the concourse of their intellectual fellows." Of course, that was especially true at Oxford and Cambridge. This is the laboratory at Girton, which was only for women, and there was one at Newnham that was only for women. And there was one woman at Girton who's sort of become one of my heroines in a way, called Hertha Ayrton. And she said this to a journalist in the early 20th century, "I don't agree with sex being brought into science at all. The idea of woman and science is completely irrelevant. Either a woman is a good scientist or she is not." And it seems to me that that articulates an ideal that we should all be pursuing now. And I'm not at all convinced that we've achieved it 100 years later, although I think we are nearer it. You may not have heard of her. She was a close friend of Marie Curie, and she specialised in electricity. And I'm going to give you two different versions of her life, because how biographies are told is significant. So I can give you a very positive, upbeat version of Hertha Ayrton as the insider. So she got a certificate in mathematics at Cambridge, and she was the first female member of the Institute of Electrical Engineers. She read a paper on electric lighting at the Royal Society, which was so well received that she won the Hughes Medal for Innovative Technology at the Royal Society. So in some ways, she was an enormously successful woman. On the other hand, you can tell a different story of her life. She didn't get a degree at Cambridge because no women were allowed to graduate until 1948, even though she passed all the exams. She was nominated to be elected at the Royal Society, but she was rejected on the grounds that she was married. And then during the war, she invented a flapper fan, which was to sort of remove noxious gases from the trenches. But she found it almost impossible to get the War Office to consider it, because by then her husband had died, she wasn't in the Royal Society, and she was excluded from all the networks that are needed to make yourself heard. So a lot of women were outsiders, but the war did give some of them opportunities that they had never had before. So I'm going to give a few examples. One of them was in the museums. So this isn't a museum curator, but it's a small antelope that's named after a woman called Dorothea Bate, who was a paleontologist, who was a museum curator. And this is a picture that she took in Mallorca, where the antelope was discovered. And this is a picture of her after the war in, I think it's in what's now called Iraq, where she's wearing all that incredibly sensible clothing of tweed skirts and hats, which is just what you need to do archaeology in Iraq. Now, she was at the museum, and then all the men started going off. But she was ineligible for a staff position because women weren't employed by the museum except on a part-time basis. So she was enrolled for 37 years on a sort of rolling basis. She was enrolled as a temporary part-time worker. And she took on more and more responsibility. I mean, she was sort of running that department, basically. And she had several men who were working beneath her as her assistants, and they were earning far more than she was. So I think she's very much an outsider, even though she was inside the museum. As far as the universities were concerned, a lot of every university in Britain more or less stopped the research projects they were engaged in and took up new ones that were devoted to war work. So here's some women chemists at university. So, for example, universities like Birmingham, Manchester and Bristol, they had topics that included explosives, tear gases, industrial fatigue, submarine detectors and pharmaceuticals. And it was the same as in the museum. As the men left, more and more women scientists were able to step into their place. And there was huge enthusiasm. This is an example by Margaret Turner, who was in Wales. And she said, "I was one of the workers preparing drugs, and I should be," this is what she wrote to the War Office, "I should be glad to hear of any further help I could give. I can put all my time and energy at your service for the next 6 weeks, and couldn't we contribute further to the needs of the country? I, for one, am willing and eager to give up all ideas of holiday while there remains so much to be done." And so there, all these women were volunteering to do the work while the men were away. The main university that was involved in wartime activities was here in London, Imperial College. And again, women were given unprecedented opportunities. So in the Army and the Air Force virtually took over Imperial College. So there was Royal Flying Corps Drawing Office was there, and there were 30 women employed in that alongside some men. Mrs. Lodge and Jackson supervised the fly room. They were trying to develop non-noxious insecticides that wouldn't be toxic for people. There had been women at Imperial College before, but they were always in the back rooms doing research. For the first time, they were allowed to come and lecture because it had been thought inappropriate for a woman to lecture to a mixed class. So they got the opportunity to lecture for the first time. And then out in the gardens in Imperial College, they dug an experimental trench to replicate the trenches at the front. And they were testing all sorts of gases and they were testing explosives. There was a team of 8 women doing that. And there was an explosive called, the code name was SK for South Kensington. So I found out something about these women. It's very difficult to find out a huge amount of information. One reason is the official secrecy concerning wartime activities. So there was this woman called Frances Micklethwaite, who was a chemist, and she was working on poison gases. And this is her obituary. During the First World War, Miss Micklethwaite carried out work of national importance and was awarded the MBE for these services in 1919. The obituary is quite long, it's about that long, but all this thing, the work that she was awarded an MBE for, we have no idea what it was because there was a sort of veil of secrecy over that. Now, she'd been working in a sort of minor scientific capacity for about 13 years. And when the war started and the men left, she was given more and more opportunities and became more and more skilled. And she stayed a scientist for the rest of her life, although I don't believe she had a degree. In contrast, someone like Martha Whiteley was already a very well-established research chemist before the war started. And she was the woman who was in charge of the experimental trenches in the gardens in Imperial College. And with her seven colleagues, she tested everything. And there was another explosive that was named just after her. It was DW for Dr. Whiteley. And as you can see from the certificate on the right, she was very engaged in feminist politics. Like the Royal Society, the Chemical Society refused to take women and they hid behind every excuse that they could find. And there was a long, tedious debate that went on for about 20 years, continually blocking the entrance of women into the Royal Chemical Society. And she was one of the campaigners and she was among the first group of women to be allowed to join the Chemical Society. And she went on to a very illustrious scientific career, but she also kept all her feminist interests and she often went round campaigning and talking to younger women, encouraging them to do science. So this is from a talk that she gave in the 1950s to a group of young women. She received the first sample of mustard gas that came back to this country from Germany. And she said, "I naturally tested it by applying a tiny smear to my arm. For nearly 3 months suffered great discomfort from the widespread open wound it caused in the bend of the elbow, and of which I still carry the scar." So she's a woman that unusually there is some more information about. And this is a letter to the War Committee from after the war. So it's got an absolutely illegible signature, but I imagine it's from a man. And it says, "The workers who remained with me, the women who remained with me, gave up many opportunities for professional advancement. I mention these facts as an index of public spirit with which these women gave their services, services which have not received any public recognition." And I think they still haven't received much public recognition. And I mean, I've been able to find the names of women. I've been able to find little bits and pieces about individuals. I've been able to find out more information about a few women. But there must be thousands of women who were very active in the war. And I don't know whether it's still possible to find out anything that they did, but there must be an awful lot of them. So I'm going to change now and talk about doctors, women as doctors. So the picture on the left is at the operating theatre in the Endell Street Hospital in London, which was run by the War Office. And it was unique in being run by the War Office, run entirely by women. And it was the women who were in charge of it were very strong suffragettes. So it was a very unusual hospital. But I'm going to talk today about field hospitals abroad, and you can see these women operating in a tent somewhere abroad. So this is a picture of women studying medicine at the London School of Medicine. And before the war, there were very, very few places where women could study medicine. There were a couple in Scotland. In London, almost all of the medical schools were for men only. But then as the war started and the men, for one thing, the male doctors went out to the front, but then also there were so many injured people that there was a great demand for doctors. So the medical schools for the first time opened up their doors to women. There was, even given that, there were huge objections to women working overseas. So Dr. Elsie English, she's that woman on the very left of the picture. She was a very keen suffrage campaigner in Scotland, and she was also a fully trained doctor. And within only two weeks of the war starting, she'd raised enough money to equip two hospital teams to go out abroad, to go to the front, to look after the men. And equipment and everything was just run entirely by women. But the War Office wasn't having that. She said, nope, go home and keep still. The commanding officers don't want to be troubled with hysterical women. So she was so furious that she went off to our allies, to Serbia, Belgium, Russia, France, and they accepted with alacrity. They thought this was a terrific idea. So one of the Scottish teams went off to France, and you can see this is Frances Ivans. She's one of the women doctor working in a disused, commandeered Cistercian monastery in Wyoming. And then the second unit that Inglis had compiled set off right at the beginning of the war. They sent off for Serbia in December 1914. And many of those women, the doctors and the nurses and the radiographers, they stayed there through the war under the most appalling conditions. There were nothing, they had to build hospitals from scratch. Supplies were very short. The weather conditions were terrible. It was freezing in the winter. It was boiling in the summer. There was lots of malaria. There was lots of dysentery. There was lots of typhus. It was really, really incredibly arduous and demoralising work that they carried out. And I know all this because there's a book by one of the women who went out there, who volunteered, called Isabel Emsley Hutton. And she came from Edinburgh and she had been a children's doctor. But as soon as the war started, she signed up and she went abroad with one of Inglis's groups. So this is just an example of one of the field hospitals that the women built. And I'm showing you a picture of a cemetery because, of course, there were huge numbers of casualties, huge numbers of people who died. And they went round behind the front lines. They were incredibly dangerous territory. They took a lot of risk. And I'm sorry, this is rather a gruesome quotation, but it's what the conditions were like. She arrived in one place. The operating room was a ghastly sight, the floor swimming in blood. Pails crammed with arms and legs black with flies lay around the old deal table on which they had been amputated. And she and some other women stayed out there until 1919, after the war was over, and they, as well as carrying out surgery on all the soldiers who were wounded, they carried out lots of restorative surgery on all the local people. So sort of chronic conditions like club feet and cleft palate and tumours that hadn't been treated. So she and the women who were with her became expert surgeons, even though normally women were only allowed to be paediatricians or do gynecology and obstetrics. Surgery was a very, very male-dominated speciality. In spite of doing all this, there was still a lot of discrimination. There was a physicist, Edith Stoney, who went along with them, and these are all the medals that she was awarded by Serbia. And she was appointed head radiologist in Salonika, but the War Office withdrew permission on the sort of very excellent grounds that a woman's never been head radiologist before, therefore she can't be now. And Hutton wrote that she thought they would have changed their minds if they'd seen how she could carry heavy loads of equipment, repair electric wires sitting astride ridge tents in a howling gale, work tirelessly on an almost starvation diet. And it seems extraordinary to me that all these women out there doing this sort of amazing stuff, sort of not just the medicine, but doing all the electric wiring and looking after themselves and building hospitals from scratch. And we never hear about them. I think it's partly because all the English commemorations focus on the Western Front rather than the Eastern Front. And these women are much better remembered in Serbia and the surrounding countries than there are here. So, for example, this is a medical school which is named after Isabel Emsley Hutton. So I'm going to move now. I'll talk about scientific leaders, and I'm going to focus now on two particular scientists who left science, one of them temporarily, one permanently, to do different kind of work. And I put this poster on the left showing how women were being appealed to work during the war. So I'm going to talk about Ray Strachey, a suffragist who organised... I'm going to talk about someone who led the army in France, and I'm also going to talk about a leading suffragist. And this is a fantastic balloon that went up, Votes for Women. You can see this woman in there, and she's throwing leaflets down over the local people. I think that's another example of how these suffrage women were very keen to embrace the latest technology, and they sort of leapt onto films and absolutely everything to show how progressive and advanced they were. So I'm going to talk first about Helen Gwynne Vaughan, and as I mentioned with Inglis, there was very much the view at the beginning of the war that it was completely inappropriate for women to go overseas. But after a couple of years, the army realised that it would be much more efficient if they could replace the men who were doing traditional women's work, such as cooking and cleaning and organisation and driving and things like that, if they could replace those men with women, release those men to go to the front and have women do those jobs. And so there was a big recruitment drive to get women into the Women's Auxiliary Army Corps. And so by the end of the war, around 60,000 women had served in the armed forces. And this woman, Helen Gwynne Vaughan, who was a botanist, was asked and agreed to lead the women's army in France. So she was in charge of a huge contingent of women out in France. And you can see her here looking rather different, dressed in her army uniform. This is a book she wrote on fungi, and she was a very, very well-respected geneticist, and she wrote, specialised in fungi. And as she said, she crossed the channel on the boat, and she went into a very new and different world. If you read her autobiography, she's obviously spent her whole time persuading the men in the army that the women weren't just there to have fun, that they were taking it seriously, that they were capable of having hard work. And the biggest arguments were about the uniforms and what they should be called and what sort of badges they should wear. And you can see this is a sort of uniform that she sort of more or less invented. And this thing of what women wearing uniforms became a focal point during the war, because for women it was very important to have a uniform as a symbol that they were fighting, that they were serious, that they were representing their country. Men, on the other hand, very strongly resented them wearing sort of what was seen as masculine clothing. And they accused... I mean, this is all over the place. They accused them of being tarts who just wanted an opportunity to be nearer men. I mean, that's the sort of language that was used. And caricatures like this, showing all the women getting themselves made up and looking good in their uniform, were just all over the place to indicate that a woman in a uniform was a complete joke and that the women weren't really interested in doing work. They just wanted to be near the men. So Gwynne Vaughan spent the whole of the war persuading the senior men in the army to take them seriously, and she just about succeeded. And the army was a brief interlude in an absolutely extraordinary career. So you can see from the picture on the left that she was born into an incredibly aristocratic family in Scotland. And it took her until she was about 21, I think, to persuade her family to let her go into science. I mean, she came out as a Deb and she was all caught up in the whole international social world. So she had enormous rows with her parents to leave. And then she became head of department of botany at Birkbeck, which is pretty extraordinary for women. And then you've got this interlude where she goes to the war. She goes to the 1917, went to France, she won a CBE. And then for 2 years after that, she commanded the Women's Royal Air Force. And then she went back to Birkbeck and she became a professor. And she continued to do science until she died in 1967. And I'll talk a bit more about what happened afterwards in the last part of the talk. The other particular individual I'm going to talk about is this woman, Ray Strachey. And again, I'm very surprised nothing has been written about her, because she married one of Lytton Strachey's brothers, and her sister married one of Virginia Woolf's brothers. So the two big families of the Bloomsbury set, the Stevens and the Strachies, are linked together by Ray Strachey and her sister, and yet nobody seems very interested in them. She became a very prominent suffrage leader. She wrote a lot of books. By the time Virginia Woolf wrote A Room of One's Own, she'd already written about 10 books and was very well known as a suffrage leader. This is just one of them that she wrote. She studied maths and engineering at Cambridge. And in a way, I empathise with her. She's an example of the leaky pipeline. I studied physics at Oxford, but I've never done any physics, and she never did any maths and engineering after she left either. But she did do lots of things. You don't have to stay in physics to do stuff. And there's two contrasting views of what it was like to be a mathematician at Cambridge. And this is by George Bernard Shaw, Mrs. Warren's Profession, which was, he wrote in about the 1890s, but it was censored and it wasn't shown on the stage till about 1910. And Ray Strachey went to watch it, and it must have been a bit like seeing herself. So this was his view, that his heroine, his mathematics undergraduate, is speaking, grind, grind, grind for 6 to 8 hours a day at mathematics. Nothing but mathematics. Outside mathematics, lawn tennis, eating, sleeping, cycling and walking. I'm a more ignorant barbarian than any woman could possibly be who hadn't gone in for the tripos. And what I far prefer is her sort of devotion to maths. I mean, this woman really wanted to learn. She wrote to her aunt, the more maths I learn, the more I wonder that anyone can call them dull or useless. They seem to me to be the most exciting and beautiful ideas, exquisitely expressed. And she kept on writing letters like that until after she'd graduated, but she only got a third because she was doing a lot of other stuff. She was captain of the Newnham cricket team. She wasn't playing lawn tennis, as Shaw thought. She was playing cricket, which is a man's game. And also she was a very keen suffrage leader at Cambridge. And she wrote to the same aunt, we've started a society which has now got more than three quarters of the college and which has joined with Girton and amalgamated to the National Society. Cambridge has become a centre of activity, meetings, debates, plays, petitions, etc., all through the term. And her family disapproved, and there's lots of letters from other parents who disapproved of everything that was going on in Cambridge. And there were also many people, men and women, who were very critical of the suffrage movement. In particular, they were critical of the militant suffragettes, the people who were chaining themselves to railings and were throwing bricks through windows and things like that. Ray Strachey didn't do that. She belonged to the sort of pacifist group of the suffragists, the majority of women who embarked on peaceful marches and protests and did a lot of behind-the-scenes committee work. So there's a sort of split in the suffrage movement, which from the film Suffragette you would have never known existed. And I think it's quite important to make that distinction. But the reputation of the suffragists and the suffragettes changed dramatically at the beginning of the First World War, because all of them, most of them anyway, almost all of them, stopped campaigning and they decided they were going to devote themselves to the war effort and they were going to start work. And you see, this is an advertising poster on the left, Learn to Make Munitions. And within 2 days after the war was declared, the National Union of Women's Suffrage Society, of which Ray Strachey was very high up in that society, she was one of the main organisers, they set up a women's bureau in London in Victoria Street. And they started recruiting women to do war work. And she helped to set up a training school to teach women how to be welders. And she stayed there throughout the war, and she was sort of organising the war effort for the women. So she helped many, many thousands of women to take over men's jobs. And I'm just going to show you a few that specifically relate to science and engineering. So there's transport, and then this woman doing some heavy engineering in a factory. This woman's making knee splints, there's medical supplies. And then munitions, which is what the majority of the women were doing. So those pictures, those examples I've just shown you, support the view that women were liberated by the war. On the other hand, they were not being treated equally. For one thing, the authorities clamped down on female enthusiasm. All the young men were going out to the front, But this is from a Newcastle student who said perhaps the most thrilling event of the term has been the appeal for women munitions makers. After 24 hours, we had permission to go. We were feeling heroic. We defied our obdurate parents and guardians in the names of patriotism and legal majority. We're feeling very Shelley-esque. It's not what modern students feel, but anyway, we were feeling Shelley-esque, and we were informed that our highest patriotic duty was to complete our education. So the women students were being told to stay at home and work. The male students were being sent off to the front. Women were also being given incredibly, incredibly repetitive work. This is a picture of Gretna, which is a 10-mile long complex up on the Scottish-English border, where essentially these women were given a little bit of training and they were following recipes, because it was very, very boring, repetitive work that was deemed simple enough for women to carry out. But it was also incredibly dangerous. You can see here, these women are wearing protective clothing. They were dealing with TNT and other explosives, and they were called canaries because their skin went yellow and their hair went bright green, and quite a lot of them died and quite a lot of them became ill. So they were doing this very dangerous, repetitive work. At the same time, they were being paid two-thirds of the pay for men doing the same work. So this older man, who's not at the war, would have been paid more than her for doing the same job. So I'll talk a bit finally about what happened after the war and pick up some of those women that I talked about. So this is immediately after the war, immediately after the armistice. It's in the courtyard of Buckingham Palace. There's this huge parade. All these women in white are the volunteers like Vera Brittain who went abroad and served as nurses. So there's this courtyard full of women. Everybody was so enthusiastic and so grateful, and the king made a speech and saying how marvellous these women were. And then it changed within about a year, although it never went back to exactly to the pre-war situation. And I know this is history. We're talking about a long while ago. We're talking about 100 years ago. I realised after I'd finished all this, I suddenly realised that my mother was born in 1918, the year the war finished. So all the interwar attitudes that I'm going to talk to you about now were the attitudes that she was brought up in amongst. So inevitably, she must have passed on those attitudes to me, and I've passed them on to my own children and to students. So there is a sense, although it was 100 years ago, this is history that is still affecting us. So immediately after the war, there was massive unemployment, and priority was always given to men. There was particular resentment against women who were married, because it was their job to stay at home and the men should look after them, and the women should not take jobs away from married men. And then ideologically, women were expected to go back to the old stereotypes of domesticity. So I mentioned this was what, during the war, they were being recruited. You can see this woman in uniform in front of the Union Jack. After the war, and this was in a newspaper, a large part of the female population of the country have had the time of their lives swaggering about in every kind of uniform. Nothing about the work they did. They must go back to being wives and mothers now that the men are coming home. And then in Sheffield, there was a special training course for metallurgists. They employed lots of women. And there they are, working during the war. On the signing of the armistice, most of the women were replaced by returning soldiers. And this took place in every single field of employment. And the women were all expected to go back, back home, while the men went out to work to support the family. And doctors were in the same position. They were needed during the war. This is another picture of Emsley Hutton. And she became, as I explained, she became very adept in surgery. And she said, "I knew that it would have been unwise and unprofitable to make surgery my life's work at home." So surgery was what she wanted to do. She couldn't. And then she made the mistake of getting married, which meant that she could no longer be paid as a doctor. She did a lot of voluntary work. She did a lot of gynecology. She did a lot of mental health work. And all those medical schools that had opened up their doors to women, phew, great relief, closed the doors again. It was just back to men. On the other hand, it wasn't, as I keep emphasising, it wasn't a complete reversion. there were far more women working before, partly because science was itself expanding. There was far greater government expenditure on science and industry. As Ray Strachey, looking back, she said herself, even at this blackest hour, just after the war, it was evident that the position of women had changed forever. Gone were the days when it was not nice to do paid work. It was a time of great difficulty, but it was one in which there was hope. But one of the campaigns that she endlessly devoted her energies to was campaigning for equal pay, which is what I said at the beginning, because there were new machinery, which meant that women could work even heavy duty jobs they could do because there was new machinery, but they were still paid less for the same work. And they were also kept in low paid, low status jobs. So, for example, I mean, the classic example is typewriters. When typewriters were introduced, that was something that women could do. As soon as it became classed as a woman's job, the pay went down to such a level that only a woman would take it, and it became a women's work. And that was what Strachey said. As one process after another came to be regarded as women's work, it became simultaneously unskilled, and the assumption that women must inevitably be routine workers deserving of only a woman's wage remained unshaken. And so another example is Dorothea Bate. I told you she was 37 years, she was classed as a temporary worker, and then in 1928 women were allowed to apply for permanent jobs, but the jobs were at such a low salary level that the women got them because the men wouldn't take them. And then more women were working before, but they were unequally treated in science and industry. So this is Kathleen Cullum, who's an industrial chemist. The male graduate is paid a reasonable salary, and however young, if his university qualifications are good, he's usually given quite a dignified position from the beginning. The girl who works side by side with him at the university is hard up and constantly humiliated. She will be happier if she is not too enterprising, because then her sense of frustration will be less. So there's this sort of fundamental level. The women, most of them, had worked far harder than the men to get to the same place, but they were paid less. And they were seen not as good scientists and not as normal women. I mean, this is a sort of dilemma for women of this period and to some extent now. You can either be a normal woman or you can be a good scientist, but you can't be both. And I think a lot of these women had a great deal of effort and difficulty negotiating a suitable an identity. So, for example, Helen Gwynn Vaughan, I mean, she started off life as a debutante, and she hated all that social life, but at least the rules were clear. She knew what she had to do. And then when she was in the army, she spent 4 or 5 years negotiating what type of uniform the women should wear, how the women should behave, what the women should be called. And then the same thing happened again when she went to Birkbeck. She ended up sort of adopting a sort of black and white quasi uniform, but she was often criticized for her behavior. She was head of the department, but she was well, one way of putting it is that she was quite controlling. Another way of putting it is that she ran the department. So the sort of behavior that would have been called authoritative in a man was called authoritarian when she was behaving in that way. And she ended up sort of being very lonely and very reclusive. And I think it must have been very difficult for her. I mean, more than any other woman of her generation, I think, she was a scientist and a military officer. She'd got to the top of both of these male-dominated territories. And then women, as well as men, resented her success. So it was very difficult for her to negotiate. And I think there still are... most of the women in this room will tell you that it still is difficult knowing exactly how to behave in certain situations. Here's another example. Two engineers. One of them writes to the other, "Please tell me, am I a lady or an engineer? This is just before a conference. Do you notice that each of the papers, there's a special side stump for ladies? Should I join in the discussion of the papers? Should I talk to the wives? Should I charm in silence? And then it says, what ho, I've made a new hat, but don't be angry about that. And then they spend the rest of the letters talking about what the hat's going to be like. And there is still unequal pay. Sorry, this is Canadian. It's the only good graph I could see. But there's still unequal pay in scientific organisations for men and for women. On the other hand, I know from talking to lots of students, female students get very disheartened and they think this is all terrible. We still haven't got equality. This is so depressing. Nothing's ever going to get better. And I hope by talking about these women and emphasising the continuity with the 19th century that I'll convince you that things have got an awful, awful lot better even since I was a student. And that's what Ray Strachey said, and I'm with her. The establishment of equality of pay and opportunity for women may lie far ahead in the future, but that it does lie there is beyond question. The day of economic emancipation will come, just as the day of political emancipation, the vote, just as that day came. So I'd like to finish on that upbeat note. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Patricia. Fantastic stuff. So we've got a bit of time for questions. So I can see Frank already. Go ahead.
Thank you, Patricia. That was super. Can I ask you to say a bit more about the relationship of all of this with notions of modernity? Because once at the end, you cited that letter to Karen Hazlitt, who's a very, very interesting figure indeed, and is one of the people who make sure in the 1920s and 1930s that electrification is associated with modernity through things like the electrical association for women. And so she quite clearly, consciously, makes that link. But where else? I mean, Gwyn Vaughan's sort of first head of the Women's World Air Force. I mean, that's quite a big job, getting something up from scratch.
Yes.
Also, I mean, is that associated with modernity and flying and the sort of ideology of British power and modernity and so on?
Well, I think that, well, as I said at the beginning, the suffragists very much aligned themselves with modernity, which is why I showed that picture of the air balloon. There were all the modern inventions. Hazlitt saw electrical inventions like dishwashers and things like that as being a force for liberation of women. I think it's rather like the typewriter. I don't think it really worked quite like that, because there were a lot of new household inventions like vacuum cleaners and electric ovens, and quite a few of them invented by women as well. But what happened, sort of a bit like the typewriters really, is that particularly after the war, when a lot of middle-class women were back at home, they had to justify all the money that had been spent on all these inventions. So instead of having servants like they did before, they had these very high demands placed on them to produce perfect meals and to run a perfect household. So I think that sort of move rather backfired. There was a group of women before the war who argued against the sort of Darwinian idea that men, through millennia of evolution, that men and women are inherently different, and they foresaw evolution into the future when the woman of today would evolve into the modern woman, and that women should take active steps. And there's a marvellous picture one of them produced of this dinosaur called a prejudicion, and it sort of snuffles around and it can't see further than the end of its nose, and it's sort of repressing all the women. So I think there was definitely an element of, I mean, there was a new woman at the end of the 19th century, and then this sort of drive towards the modern woman, and all the stuff about cycling and wearing different clothes. That, absolutely, yeah.
Bill.
Yeah, thank you. Really
beautifully
rich material. Thinking more in terms of my background, more in history of science.
Could you speak a bit louder? Sorry.
Sure. I'm thinking just in terms of the historiography of just gender and women in the early 20th century, and much of what you're describing is actually, as you well know, I'm sure, part of the traditional historiography of the transformations of gender and
yeah.
And employment. But one of the elements that strikes me as most interesting in all of what you said is the argument that's made that patriotism for some of these women is to complete your education.
Mm.
So it's not to enlist or enroll in a munitions factory, but something a bit more than that. I mean, so it might be manual training, but also that there's that sense of kind of that they're redefining this term. Now, I'm wondering how much of that notion of the way they're defining patriotism, are they coming up with that idea that this is how they're going to show?
So who's they? The women?
Sorry, the women who are...
No. It was the War Office or something. It was the War Office who said that they had to, stay and they couldn't sign up. I mean, it was the same. Vera Brittain writes about that she was left behind at Oxford and her boyfriend, her fiance, was went off overseas and she wanted nothing more than to go overseas, and so she fought to be allowed to join the volunteer aid detachments.
The point is that they're redefining, someone is redefining patriotism as completing education. That sense that
that is the only reference I have seen to that. I mean, perhaps that was an excuse for keeping the women at home, because there was a huge surge of patriotism. I mean, I can imagine someone saying, "Look, the best thing you can do for the country is to stay at home and learn," but. I agree, because that doesn't quite go with the view that women shouldn't be being educated, women should be staying at home. But I mean, I haven't seen any indication that that's part of a larger trend. I just like the quotation because it's so indicative of the way that men and young men and women were being treated in completely different directions.
Just on that point of patriotism, actually, because I'm looking at a group of women in the Napoleonic Wars.
Yeah.
Patriotism comes up, not in the same kind of munitions factories kind of way, but patriotism is defined, that patriotism is, they're told what type of patriots they should be,
yeah.
And actually they're told to be, basically to be mothers, so it's the domestic imperative, that's what you're doing for the country, you bear sons, you're born to do all these kind of things, so I definitely think, I mean, maybe there'll be more instances where education, you stay and do your education, that's part of your patriotic role. But it is, in wartime, it is weird that you're told to do this and that's what's good for your country. And it is, I don't know how I'm doing.
The thing that was said most often is after the war there were 11 women for every 10 men. So the thing that was seen as being truly patriotic is that women should have children. And they should rear healthy children, especially boys, for the benefit of the British nation. So for example, one of the reasons that women were discouraged from going to Oxford or Cambridge, or at least after they'd finished at Oxford or Cambridge, then it was their duty to marry a man and bring up lovely, well-educated children to benefit the British nation. There was also, going back to patriotism, there was quite a strong division in the suffrage movement between women who wanted to support the war effort and others who were such strong pacifists that they thought that it was completely wrong to do anything to support it at all. And there was a big international women's pacifist conference in the Hague, I think it was. So there's the suffragettes being very, very violent, and then there's the suffrage movement who only demonstrate peacefully, but think it's their patriotic duty overrides everything else. And even though a lot of them feel that women are born to be nurturing and caring, and it's the men's job to go out and fight. Even so, their patriotic responsibility is to contribute to the war effort. And then there's another smaller group who think that they shouldn't have, Virginia Woolf, for example, who think that they shouldn't have anything to do with the war at all. So the whole, you're right, I mean, the whole thing of patriotism, what it means to be a patriot, is quite diverse, absolutely. And especially when you get all these things of the women women giving the men white poppies. The men, the at the beginning of the war, suffrage women were going around giving white poppies to men who weren't in uniform, who hadn't volunteered. And of course, there are all sorts of reasons why they hadn't volunteered. Some of them had volunteered and been discharged because they were ill. Some of them wanted to sign up and couldn't. And that was a practice that was much frowned upon.
Sadie.
You touched upon a couple of things just now that I was wondering if you could expand upon this. I work in the 18th century, and I work on women right now in the 18th century, and a lot something that I notice quite a lot of is, and I'm sure Hattie does as well, the use of the rhetoric around a woman's role and a woman's naturally nurturing disposition as being something that women that while it held them back from full participation, it was something that they could use to kind of appropriate to gain access to. So for the example that I'm working with is the Salonniers, who said that they were nurturing and civilizing forces, therefore men...
But that's
them.
Is that in France or here?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's very much a French approach, and I think it was very different in England, where you got a much greater sort of division of the sexes, that social groups were all men and all women, whereas in France you've got these mixed salons, and
exactly
the civilising influence of women.
How much it needed to be mixed sex in order for it to be like society.
Yeah.
But I was wondering if you came across any strong sense that women were co-opting their stereotypes in order to advance themselves, and how that iterated itself in the First World War.
Yeah, well, immediately after the war, there were two very strong strands of feminism, and there were women like Cicely Hamilton that I quoted, mainly the older women, who were absolutely committed to economic and professional parity. But there was also another very large group of women who... I think they call themselves the New Feminists, I think. I'm not sure. Anyway, another group of women who said they wanted financial parity, but the way to get that was for them to stay at home and fulfil their patriotic duty of bringing up children, but be paid a salary for it, so that financially they would be equal with men, but that there would be two different roles that they would fulfil. Yeah, this is interesting. H.G. Wells, he wrote a book called Modern Utopia, I think, which is a very strange book. One of the things he suggests in that book is exactly that women should be paid a salary, and the more children they have, especially good, nice, healthy boys, to go out to the front and get killed, presumably. But anyway, the more nice, healthy boys they raise, the better the more their salary should be, and then they can have an independent existence. So that was his contribution to the suffrage movement. Well, he also wrote a very interesting book. It's a novel. It's not a very good novel, but from my perspective, it's quite interesting, called Ann Veronica, who is a suffragist, and her father just completely fails to understand why she doesn't want to stay at home and all that stuff. And she goes out and works in a lab, and he describes all the work that she does in the laboratory and all the problems she has. And she's got this marvellous phrase about, you can't understand what it's like to do science in petticoats.
So I've got the question that I think connects to Sadie's question, which is, do you have a sense of, so clearly there is a clear public aspect to the suffragettes movement. It was clearly an outward facing demonstrations, peaceful or not. But do you have a sense of women also creating like more hidden networks of mentoring and
yes,
helping each other? And is there a sense in the documentation, any kind of interesting systems or devices that women found to communicate with each other, to support each other?
Yeah, I mean, there were endless networks of committees, and there were all sorts of volunteer organisations. They sort of set themselves up and they sort of split themselves into little armies. They did all sorts of volunteer thing, and they put on their uniforms and they went off and they were driving ambulances and stuff like that. Yes, there was I think it was a huge network. Yes, very much so.
I was thinking more about like the, not so much the committee side of the story, but more about, so you said, for example, I don't remember her name, the birdback botanist.
Gwen Vaughan.
It was extremely difficult to negotiate who your identity as a woman.
Yeah.
So was there any kind of system or network with something equivalent to what we would do now in our mentoring role?
I think there was. She, she held herself aloof. Mm. I mean, I can quite see that she might have been quite a difficult woman to deal with, but on the other hand, she was in an unusual position because she was the head of department amongst other women. Yeah, I mean, they're always writing to each other and advising each other and asking each other what to do. So for example, there was Ray Strachey was involved in, during the war. She was involved in organising all these, the Scottish suffrage hospital movement, all the people who went out to Serbia. And one of her best friends from Newnham went out there as a doctor. And this doctor was, there's loads of correspondence back where she's reporting to Ray Strachey on all the allegiances between different women out in Serbia, and then also all the animosities and how we don't think you should have appointed that woman because she really annoys everybody. On the other hand, this woman's really good because she goes around looking after everybody and helping them. So I think when they were flung into those situations together, there was a huge sense of sort of sisterly solidarity, and they were always looking after each other and putting on performances and making sure that they had Christmas lunch and all that sort of stuff. I think one reason why prevailing against setting up networks is that any given professional position, each woman was pretty much alone. I was at the Endell Street Hospital, where they're all women. They say that it's a huge feeling of family community and solidarity and support for each other. But if you're only one woman in an institute, it's difficult. There was a woman who went to Teddington, the National Research Laboratory, and National Physics Laboratory. And by the time she got there were already about 10 other women there. So she felt okay and she felt at home. But if you were just one, like Gwen Vaughan, just one isolated in a department, I think it was really, really difficult. And I think it's a sort of dilemma. I mean, I think she got lonelier and the more she held herself aloof, but it was impossible for her to communicate. And I think it was very difficult for her. And she got a reputation for being very sort of curmudgeonly, but in a way it was sort of forced upon her, I think.
Marisha.
Hi.
Hi there. And following on this, what about the role of male colleagues? So in these circumstances where she felt lonely in the place where she was, how would the male colleagues respond to that? Do you have any sense of any alliances between the woman you've told us and the male colleagues? So you showed us one statement from St. Andrews University, which was sympathetic. You said that the signature looked like a male signature.
Yeah.
So,
there was something about the rest of the letter, which I didn't quote, which just made me think that it was a man. Yeah.
So my question is, do you have a sense of how these women, if they ever received any sort of support,
how they related
alliances
to
from
men,
their male colleagues beyond the female implicit network?
Quite a few of them got strong support from their husbands or their brothers. There was a lot of that. I don't think it was sort of really proper to have sort of close, friendly associations with men who weren't your immediate family. But Ray Strachey, for instance, she had two children. But then, as far as I can make out, Oliver Strachey went off and had affairs with loads of other women, and with other women, and she also went off and had affairs with other women. But yet they had this very, very close sort of companionship sort of relationship. So I think it was mostly with family that they had that, rather than colleagues. Although there was this sort of secret room at the bottom of the Admiralty, where they did code breaking and all the German codes came in. And that was a very mixed group of men and women. And at the end of the war, one of them, wrote a play. They're based on Alice in Wonderland, which was a sort of satire on themselves. And the men and the women all had nicknames for each other, but which was sort of friendly and sort of antagonistic, as nicknames always are. So I think that was a very unusual example of a group that became very close-knit, because nobody knew that they existed. It was completely secret, and they were working 24 hours a day, and they often slept there. So they were a sort of a little unit, I mean, rather like the women at the Endell Street Hospital. So I think in that circumstance, the men and the women did develop close relationships, but I think that was quite unusual, as far as I can make out. Because the play is absolutely extraordinary. It's really funny.
I have a question about the kind of longer term image of, and memory of these women. Because if I think of stories about women in work, in wartime, in the 20th century, the first example that comes to mind, and obviously I will be slightly biased here, is Russia. Mm-hmm. And there's this very, very strong kind of socialist narrative, Marxist, Soviet narrative about women in work, and they're very, very present in the sort of visual representation of the Soviet Union and so on and so forth. Is that whereas this is all really kind of news, and I'm actually sort of surprised. I really never come across, particularly the women, the 60,000 women in the British Army in the First World War, is not something I've come across before. So
they weren't fighting.
No, sure, but even just that I don't think that is something that's kind of common, as widespread an image as it should be.
Yeah.
So is there something, were there associations with socialism that sort of reduced, that led to that kind of amnesia in Britain?
No, I think it was the way that they were represented in the media. So if you do think back about women in the war, you will think probably of Vera Brittain, who went off and volunteered and became a nurse, typical caring role. You'll probably think of Edith Cavell, a nurse who was martyred. I think the media images of these women were really quite carefully controlled, and they conformed to various stereotypes. I mean, rather like the men suffering on the battlefields and all the films about the war that they're made now, there's a certain sort of rather horrific glamour in them, whereas I think actually it was long periods of being very cold and very bored, whereas it's all shown as being very glamorous. And I think it's the same with the women. You see all these sort of cheerful women carrying buckets of coal and doing all sorts of stuff, and they're always smiling. But then the icons, the ones we remember, are the ones who were in traditional caring roles. And the professional doctors and nurses didn't like all the VADs, the voluntary aid detachments, because they weren't being paid, they hadn't been trained, they weren't professional, and they were reinforcing this notion that any woman can go and be a carer, but women aren't good for anything else. So those are some of the sort of internal antagonisms that I think have been concealed because of the way the media was manipulated at the time. And also, I don't know, a film like Suffragette, Suffragette was far better than I thought it was going to be, but it showed this woman in the washing in the laundry as though she was sort of like practically at the top of the suffrage organisation, whereas in fact it was almost exclusively a middle class organisation in the upper echelon. So virtually no women, working class women, who were actually organising anything. It was very undemocratic, because the whole class differential was as pervasive as the gender differential, and that was acting at the same time. So I found this marvellous book by a woman, I can't remember her name, it was one of those incredible aristocratic British double-barreled names, and she said, oh, it's such a shame, these women who are cooks and servants, they're all leaving and they're all going off to the factories to earn pin money. And what they should realise is that committee women like me, we need a really nice hot dinner when we go back. So the best thing they could do for the war would be to stay and look after us committee women. So, I mean, there was a sort of class differentials among the women, as well as sort of the gender differentials between the men and the women.
And I was going to ask also I mean, related to that, about the kind of skills transfer.
Mm.
So when women are moving from more domestic positions into work, into the military, into the medical roles, do they bring skills that they had as mothers and housewives into those roles?
They certainly bring a lot of common sense, because there's I found this marvelous quotation by a woman who was an engineer, and she was pointing out to the men that she was working with, well, if you just did it this sort of slightly different way, it would all work much better. And of course, none of the men would listen to what she had to say. But one of the benefits was that they did bring in extra machinery, because the women weren't strong enough to do some of the work. So they brought in extra machinery so that the women can do it. And that, of course, benefited the men after the war. But there was actually quite a lot of debates, battles with the trades unions about how much the women were paid and how much work they took over. But that's an aspect of it I haven't really looked at. I mean, lots of historians have, but I really wanted to focus on this really small group of sort of professionally trained scientists and engineers and doctors who'd been to university. I mean, that's the group that nobody has ever looked at.
Hi. So the caricature that you showed us of the women preening.
Oh, yeah, there's loads of those.
There are loads. So are there any of the men doing it? Because there are plenty of stereotypes of male soldiers in the Napoleonic Wars. Showing up in their uniform and luring members of the opposite sex away into, I'm thinking of Jane Austen novels.
Yeah.
So it's quite interesting that it's changed, because I guess you did have, there was a stereotype of a man in uniform that was trying to distract away the opposite sex, and that existed in the 19th century, but it's strange that it did sort of twist in the 20th century too. Was it only a...
No, I mean, I haven't... seen it. I mean, there is a book about medicine in the First World War, and there's only two references to women in it, and one is to the voluntary aid detachments. The other one is to the big debates in France about whether British soldiers should be allowed to go into the French brothels. And that's the only... So, I mean, there's this awful stuff. I mean, any woman in a uniform was sort of assumed to be sort of seducing the men. They just weren't being taken seriously. I mean, I haven't looked for caricatures of men, and it may well be that they exist. So you talked about the Women's Army Corps, the WAAC, the WACS. So one of the jokes that Gwyn Vaughan had repeatedly to fight again. There's loads of cartoons of this as well, caricatures. Something like a slap on your head is better than a whack on your knee, or something like that. I can't remember exactly. So there's these pictures of these soldiers with the whack over their knee being slapped. I can't remember exactly what it is, but it's sort of... It's something, I mean, that sort of stuff is just going on the whole time. And yet for the women, it was important to have a uniform, partly so that people would know who they were. Because, like, if you were abroad, you could be accused of being a prostitute or a spy trying to enter the camp. If you had a uniform, you were identified as a legitimate British person.
There's a fantastic paper by Norman Brighton about how effeminacy was an expression of masculinity in the uniforms of Napoleonic soldiers in Jean Rousseau's paintings. Yeah, very good. Frank?
I was just wondering whether you could tell similar stories about what was going on in the Central Powers at the same time. I mean, did Germany and Austria have similar issues because they had exactly the same problem of manpower? Did women go into German armament factories?
I haven't looked at it in any detail, because I thought England was probably enough. But I think it's rather different. So in Russia, for example, at the very beginning of the war, all the doctors were sent to the front, which meant there were no doctors in the hospital. So loads of our female doctors went straight out to Russia. There were also differences in whether between Germany and Britain about whether the factories were built by the state or whether they were owned privately. So, I mean, I think the general sort of pattern is the same, but it I don't know in any detail. Sorry.
Because you've pointed out feminism at the time was very diverse, the suffragette movement had different strands. So I wonder whether the story you've told us, there's another story, another history of perhaps the suffragette movement actively or trying to convince women not to get into science, because science at the time was a war effort and perhaps an effort that eventually contributed to the nomination of women. So I'm just wondering whether there was anything of this sort at the time. Because from a contemporary point of view, I think feminism would nowadays perhaps make an argument of this sort, where they would say, well, science in itself is not intrinsically related to modernity. And so I wonder whether that debate in the suffragette movement in favor of pacifism actually feed up into, in terms of discouraging women getting into science.
I think, I mean, you talk about a feminist position now. I don't think there is a feminist position now, and I don't think there was a feminist position then. So there was one debate, for example, which is relevant. There was a census in, I can't remember, 1912, 1914, something like that. And there was one group of women who said, we absolutely should not contribute to the census because this is the state is counting us and we're making us into items of data. And so the women, all the suffrage organisation organised sort of places for all the women to go so that they weren't at home at midnight when the census was being taken, so they would be concealed. So there's one group of people who's saying we don't want this. We don't want science with a big S overtaking us and dominating our lives. There was another group of women, some of them scientists themselves, who said, no, the only way that we can improve the condition of women is through having scientific knowledge of what's happening. And there were ways in which the war did benefit women. For example, there's much better, the state was putting provision into childcare, and the women who were working in the factories, they had doctors and nurses looking after them because a healthy woman worker is more use than a sick one. So it wasn't disinterested, but at least they were doing it. And there was better welfare provision, much better maternity provision during and after the war, with the intention of raising all these young, healthy boys for the nation. So I think it was a very mixed picture. I mean, there women... There isn't a feminist consensus at all.
Yeah. And I don't think that's what perhaps the picture you've given us. It's one.
It's my personal.
So the thing is whether there was any sense for you that actually women perhaps actively decided to exclude themselves from science because maybe they associated it with.
I'm sure there were some women who did. They're not the sort of women that I would find, would I? Perhaps most of them were doing that. I mean, I just think it's interesting that there were a few women who were doing really high-powered stuff.
Okay, any more questions? Well, just before we finish, Malcolm has the essential STS bag and something else inside.
Thank you very much.
Fantastic seminar, and let's please.
We've got things inside. Thank you.